Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome back to the final panel of our Conference on Academic Freedom. My name is Setsu Shigematsu, and I'm an associate professor here at UC Riverside in the Department of Media and Cultural Studies. It's a great honor to be part of this panel and serve as moderator for these speakers who will be speaking on Taboo Words, Israel, Apartheid, and Settler Colonialism. Nada Eli is a scholar, activist, and member of the U.S. ACBI Steering Collective. She was the past president of the Association for Middle East Women's Studies, a former representative of the UN, the Arab Women Solidarity Association, and a founding member of the Radical Arab Women's Activist Network. She is currently completing her book, Who You Calling Demographic Threat? Notes from the Global Intifada.
Thank you. I also want to start by thanking everyone for being here, and David and Lubna for organizing. Thank you very much. This has been wonderful. It's really been invigorating, though frustrating at times, and I think we're going to talk about all of this. I'm not actually going to talk much about academic freedom, because coming at the end of 2 days of discussing this, I think there are some other taboo topics we need to talk about. So I want to speak not necessarily about the lack of academic freedom creating a hostile environment. I want to speak about another space that's also supposed to be a forum for discussion of various supposedly controversial issues, and yet where one nevertheless finds oneself in the invisibilized majority. And I say invisibilized rather than invisible, because we seem to be front and center, and yet our circumstances are rarely discussed. And by doing so, by not talking about the circumstances of the majority, basically, we are in some ways reproducing Zionist discourse. And so I'm going to explain what I mean by that. So, movements that seek to redress wrongs in a partial manner, prioritizing some over others, are bound to ultimately fail as they cement the priorities they had conveniently selected during the struggle. So, lifting the siege on Gaza is beyond urgent, as the situation there has correctly been described as slow genocide. Ending the 48-year occupation of the West Bank is also of paramount importance, as the psychological, environmental, educational, economic, and overall social damage of living with no dignity or sovereignty grows more detrimental with each passing day. And I wrote this before the latest spike in violence. Stopping the ethnic cleansing and home demolitions of East Jerusalem is critical, as the living circumstances for Palestinian residents of the city are now barely better than those in Gaza. And while Palestinians as a whole hold the unenviable title of being a refugee people for the longest period in modern history, one thing we have learned from other struggles is that our liberation must not and cannot be partial, a liberation of the few. So Palestinians today in Israel, in the West Bank, in Gaza, in Lebanon, in the US, everywhere we happen to be organizing, are organizing for complete liberation. Equal political rights for all Palestinians should mean exactly that, all Palestinians, meaning the Palestinians who never left the ancestral homeland, and the refugees, be they internally displaced or in Gaza, in the West Bank, in the USA, and wherever our diaspora has taken us. Today, only an estimated 12% of the Palestinian people live inside Israel. 50% live outside of historic Palestine. Palestinians in the West Bank and Gaza include refugees from towns and villages within Israel, as well as internally displaced people from land confiscated inside the West Bank to create the military outposts, the Jewish-only roads, and the Jewish-only settlements. The fact that some of us in the diaspora are now people like me. The fact that some of us in the diaspora are now unrecognized as Palestinians as a result of our forced exile and dispossession must not eclipse the reality that we are all Palestinians, and that our assertion of this identity goes beyond the cliché statement of solidarity. I am extremely aggravated by t-shirts that say we are all Palestinian without an appreciation of what we are all Palestinian really means, and it means people who are not recognized as Palestinians. There's this blurring of identity that happens with solidarity, with claiming an identity out of empathy that actually in some ways invisibilizes the Palestinians who are not recognized as Palestinians. As we homogenize, we are all Palestinians. So indeed, as we enact the homeland in our everyday life, some of us do not identify with Palestine as a nation state, but rather as a state of identity. And denying us this identity plays into Israel's agenda of erasing us so as not to address our violated rights. Interestingly, there's a lot of discussion about Palestine with, you know, excellent, extremely important studies of Palestine and its indigenous people. And these are readily available, and some of them focus on Palestine before the Nakba, and others are Palestine pre-48, and then 48, 67. And then there's all these divisions about discussions of Palestine. And these studies are important, you know, to basically counter the Zionist narratives of a land without a people for a people without a land. And they also not just counter it, but they actually then recenter the actual discourse, like when Israeli Zionist sociology textbooks, for example, erase our Nakba, and geography books erase the names of our towns and villages. All of the books that I'm citing that are studies of the actual historic Palestine are really important in re-inscribing our discourse and our narrative and our history and our experience. And yet they still do not encompass the majority of Palestine today, because the majority of Palestine today lives outside the boundaries of historic Palestine. So the erasure of the Palestinian people, when we look at these historic studies, the erasure of the Palestinian people takes on an even more serious turn in allied circles who claim solidarity with the Palestinian people, yet seem willing to jettison the rights of the exiled majority who are now in the Shatat, in the diaspora. And there are even exceptions to this, but the exceptions don't do enough to shift the discourse sufficiently so that there is a discussion of the Palestine diaspora. And even as these exceptions speak of, for example, you know, I'm thinking of, let's say, Gabriel Petersburg's very aptly entitled essay, Erasures, which talks about the fact that the Zionists are even more, whatever the, if you want, the continuum of Zionism, the one unifying aspect of Zionism is the erasure of the right of return, because when you speak of a 48 Israel, 67, you know, that chunk Israel proper, as they call it, you're still talking about a displacement. So within that, the spectrum of Zionism, there is an erasure of the right of return. So my contention in all of my activism, all of my writing, and in this essay is that partial solutions, or the liberation of the few, or liberation for the few, say in the West Bank or Gaza, partial solutions, not only are they inadequate, but they actually compound rather than solve the problem. So my emphasis personally is on the larger Palestinian people in the diaspora, not necessarily because we are the majority. I mean, I'm not into numbers and statistics and and oppression Olympics and all of that, not because we're in the majority, which we happen to be, but because we are indeed all Palestinians, and as such, we do wish to regain the human rights denied us, both at home and in the diaspora, through the denial of our right of return. And yet there seems to be a normative discourse that views some Palestinians as a demographic threat, which is the title of my next book, Who You Call in Demographic Threat. There's a normative discourse that views some Palestinians as a demographic threat or ticking bombs and not others. This normative discourse was foregrounded in a 2013 study that says that Palestinians will outnumber Israeli Jews in 2020, and explaining that while Palestinians in Israel, the West Bank and Gaza currently number 5.8 million compared to the 6 million Israeli Jews, with the Palestinian birth rate as it is, slightly higher than that of the Israeli Jews, the two populations will be equal in 2016. Oh my gosh. And the balance will tip in favor of the Palestinians in 2020, who will then number 7.2 million Palestinians to Israeli Jews at 6.9 million. And so the counter discourse that comes in response to statistics, to studies like this, says, oh, how racist that one should be comparing the birth rates and 5.8, 6.2, 7.9. But this counter discourse actually continues the erasure of the Palestinians because it does not consider the Palestinians in the diaspora who already outnumber. I mean, if we're going to talk about studies and outnumbering and majority and minority and birth rates and everything, why are we not counting the entire Palestinian people? And if we are not counting the entire Palestinian people, then we are condoning the Zionist narrative that displaces us and denies us long term, forever, our human rights. If we do not consider that someone like me is a demographic threat, if we're ever going to think of demographic threats, and we don't consider someone like me as a demographic threat, then we are buying into the Zionist discourse, and that compounds the problem rather than solves it. So beyond the birth rates of Palestinians in historic Palestine and the greater demographic threat to Israel is the one that Israel does not acknowledge. It is the refugees scattered around the globe beyond the borders of historic Palestine, as well as their allies. Our circumstances are extremely diverse. Tens of thousands were born and have died in refugee camps. We can speak of Sabra and Shatila, and I'm going to rush through this because I have a feeling I've got a very educated audience here. So, you know, the circumstances of the Palestinian diaspora from Sabra and Shatila to Yarmouk to here the United States and, you know, even Iraq, with every development in the Middle East, we realize, oh, there's Palestinians in Syria too, there's Palestinians in Iraq too, there's Palestinians in Jordan. It's like we're everywhere. And we also have to understand the diversity of the circumstances, with basically the one unifying factor that we are not considered when there's talks of, you know, the Palestinians outnumbering the Israelis. Millions are scattered in the non-Arab diaspora, and with wherever we are, Palestinians are organizing in a multiplicity of languages with any number of strategies, and we are looking to Palestine, and we are saying, in fact, that's what it says on my t-shirt, but by now I'm warm, but my sweatshirt, we will return. That is a right. And whether we return geographically or return as an identity, I'm not a nationalist. I don't believe in the nation state. I will never wrap myself in the flag of any country, not even Palestine, not even with the denial of the right to have a Palestinian flag. You know, it's like, this is not what I want, but I am Palestinian, and I have to have that acknowledged. Otherwise, we are dealing with this. We are condoning and accepting and strengthening the Zionist discourse. So, as such, more than any political ideologies, we are the demographic threat confronting Israel as it seeks to erase our very existence. It doesn't matter how we left Palestine. There's all these talks, you know, that, you know, you left because the Arab leaders lied to you, or you left thinking for 2 weeks, or, you know, you left because you were. It doesn't matter how we left. We have a right of return, and to take that right of return from us by accepting a Zionist discourse that no longer counts us in the calculations of demographic threats is the denial of our existence and the denial of our rights. So my research and my studies and all of my activism and organizing talks very much about the diaspora. But I also want to talk about, you know, the invisibilized people. And very importantly, I also want to say that in our focus on certain aspects of Palestine, we are invisibilizing the millions of non-Palestinians who are also impacted by Zionism. So Palestinians and our allies are not the only victims of Zionism. I said Palestinians and our allies. So everyone in this room who's an ally who's impacted by Zionism, we are not the only victims of Zionism. We do need to stop erasing things like the Golan Heights as occupied land. That one map that I think Shireen started with, which the MSB, the one that was on TV a few days and then was taken down, was like, and a fact check, it actually had the Golan Heights at the very top of that map as occupied land. It was really interesting that was one of the very few maps we have of, you know, the four maps that actually included the Golan Heights. So we need to stop erasing other parts of the world that are impacted by Zionism. We need to remember the cyclical attacks on Lebanon when we speak of Israeli violence. I mean, the attacks on Lebanon every now and then, 2006, I believe, being the latest. No, there must have been something since 2006. You know, when we speak of repeated assaults, military assaults, they don't only happen in Gaza and the West Bank. We need to understand the repression of Jordanians and Egyptians as a result of the supposed peace agreements between Egypt and Jordan and Israel. We need to think of Iran. I mean, Iran is also a victim of Zionism. Zionism does not only impact Palestinians and certainly does not only impact Palestinians in Palestine. We need to keep in mind the U.S. communities here in the U.S. that are impacted by the militarization of police here, a police force trained by Israel or by Israelis. We need to speak of the U.S.-Mexico border wall in the same breath as we speak of the apartheid wall, because they are even built by the same company, Elbit. We need to keep in mind that our social services here suffer as we increase funding to Israel. Zionism is a hyper-militarized system of state oppression and structural violence with a global impact way beyond Palestine, way beyond the U.S. Academy. So as we speak of invisibilizing of other communities, as I said, let's not be so short-sighted in our analysis that we invisibilize chunks and chunks of people impacted by Zionism. And I also want to say, speaking of soft Zionism is like speaking of soft sexism, you know. So if you don't beat your wife, that's okay? No. If you're sexist, you're sexist. It's not okay. If you're Zionist, you're Zionist. It's not okay. So today, the urgency of what is going on in the homeland makes us once again focus on that blood-soaked country. Yet as we plan for the future, we need to be wary of partial solutions. Once we put out the fire, every unresolved issue is a potential spark that will reignite it. So let's keep our eyes on the prize. We are not only seeking an end to the occupation and the lifting of the siege. We want justice for all Palestinians and for all people impacted by Zionism. As we fight to overthrow Zionism, we need to understand Zionism not only as a form of racism, but as one of the many global manifestations of imperialist, expansionist settler colonialism. Zionism, the privileging of one perceived ethnic group over another, is by necessity, by definition, a form of institutionalized structural violence. So we are fighting structural violence, we are fighting racism, and racism does not exist without sexism, without homophobia, without classism, without ableism, without violence. This is something we need to understand and center in our struggles. History shows us again and again that partial solutions, solutions that prioritize certain oppressions over others, are not solutions. They cement, upon achieving a first success, the hierarchy of oppression they had neglected to address during the struggle. First things first might sound convenient, it is ultimately counterproductive. Without engaging in oppression Olympics, we need to address the circumstances of all those impacted by Zionism. Whether what is going on now in Palestine is a third intifada or not, and I actually don't think it's a third intifada because I don't want to number them, and if I were to number them, I would call it more than the third intifada, but I also think that it's a global intifada, and that, if anything, is what distinguishes it from the first two. I don't want to get into naming the intifadas because I believe that there's more than two. So whatever is going on now, a third intifada or not, what must rise out of the ashes of an unjust system is self-determination for all. Palestinians have, whether we want it or not, Palestinians have become a model of sumud, persistence under the harshest of circumstances. We can and should also become a model of freedom and justice for all post-colonialism, post-apartheid, and post-Zionism. We are not in this only to free Palestine. We are in this to abolish Zionism, and the sooner the better. Thank you.
Second, we are pleased to have Mohammed Abed from Cal State Los Angeles. He is an assistant professor in the Department of Philosophy, and he works on ethics, social and political philosophy, classic Islamic philosophy, and he has written an important article, which is on the U.S. ACBI website, called In Defense of Academic Boycotts.
Good afternoon, everybody. I'm really happy to be here today. I think it's really difficult to overstate the importance of continuing to cast a critical eye on Israel's treatment of the Palestinian people, especially in the current climate of intimidation and attacks on those who refuse to quietly acquiesce to the standard narrative about Israel in the United States. So in light of that, I'm really grateful to Dr. Lloyd for all of his hard work in putting on this event. And I'd also like to thank Lubna, I'm not sure if she's here, for all of her assistance. And thanks to all of you for coming, of course. So I'm sure all of you know by now that the title of this panel is Taboo Words, Israel, Apartheid and Settler Colonialism. What I'm gonna do is complicate things a little bit and add another word into the mix, and that word is genocide. So I think that this is a helpful and constructive addition for a bunch of different reasons. So to begin with, genocide is the word that, in my view, best captures the dynamics of Zionist and then Israeli policy when it's considered in historical perspective. Use of the word can enrich our understanding of the events and the territories that Israel now controls. The second reason is that in the field of genocide studies and also in the public domain, there's widespread and vigorous disagreement about the meaning of the word genocide and, more fundamentally, the content of the concept itself. Analysis of Israeli policy and practice, which is not a common occurrence in genocide studies, can help us, I think, focus this conceptual debate and may even shed some light on key features of the phenomenon. At the very least, it will help us to clarify the issues at stake. Third, and I'm not going to have time to say all that much about this, but I think by examining how the Israel-Palestine issue has been dealt with in genocide studies, we can maybe gain some insight into the subtle but no less pernicious ways in which intimidation and censorship function in scholarly contexts. So a quick disclaimer before I get stuck into the meat of the argument. I am a specialist in genocide studies. However, I'm not an expert in the history of the Israeli-Palestinian conflict. So I will limit, in the discussion that follows, I'll limit myself to facts and interpretations of historical events that are widely accepted by scholars who do have expertise in the area. So first of all, I want to explain the definition of genocide that I happen to favor. Then I'll address the issue of whether Israel's treatment of the Palestinians, its policies in historical Palestine, actually fit the definition. And after considering some common objections, I'll make one or two brief remarks about how the issue is dealt with in genocide studies. So in my academic work, I've argued for the idea that genocide is an unfolding process of destruction that typically consists of a number of policies and practices. These policies and practices deliberately undermine the social, the political, economic, and other conditions that make it possible for the members of a group to have a life in common. And the ultimate objective, of course, is the liquidation of the targeted collective. In order for a collection of individuals to count as a protected group, they must have, in my view, a comprehensive worldview and way of life. And groups that satisfy this requirement are typically intergenerational. So, for example, Israelis and Palestinians count, while subcultures and the class of individuals who've managed to publish a paper on genocide, right, do not. If a subculture becomes intergenerational and its doctrines and way of life develop to become more structured and inclusive, then they may be entitled to protected status, on my view. The requirement that groups be destroyed intentionally means that it would be inappropriate to use the word genocide in describing, for example, the policies of a government that incentivizes a national minority to assimilate. And then finally, this is the quick sketch of the conception. Finally, social alienation, according to this account, is the characteristic harm of genocide. So the point of departure for the conception that I've now very quickly sketched for you is the definition of genocide that was given by the Polish legal theorist Raphael Lemkin in his famous work, Axis Rule in Occupied Europe. So I follow Lemkin in thinking that mass murder is one of the many techniques of genocide that have an impact on different fields of human activity. Lemkin says very clearly, right at the beginning of the chapter on genocide in Axis Rule, and this is a quote, "Generally speaking, genocide does not necessarily mean the immediate destruction of a nation, except when accomplished by mass killings of all members of a nation. It is intended, rather, to signify a coordinated plan of different actions aiming at the destruction of essential foundations of the life of national groups, with the aim of annihilating the groups themselves," end quote. So basically, the idea is that groups, like individuals, can be quote-unquote killed in a variety of different ways. And a bunch of different considerations have historically moved perpetrators to destroy them. So regarding the point about the first point, the one about mass murder, the philosopher Raymond Gaita poses the following question to people who insist that genocide is a species of mass murder. Would the forcible sterilization of a group carried out with the intent of destroying them as a people count as genocide? What if, for instance, the Nazis had attempted to liquidate the European Jews by sterilizing each and every member of the community? So if you claim that mass sterilization should not be classified as genocide, then you run into some serious problems, because it implies that the intentional annihilation of groups is not a core feature of the phenomenon. If you answer yes to the question, that suggests that you should follow Lemkin in thinking that in decoupling genocide and mass murder. Regarding the second issue, the issue of motive, it's not at all clear to me why only racial motives can lie behind the destruction of groups. The historian Dirk Moses calls this particular view of genocide the hate crime model. And the problem with this model is that it fails to accommodate, amongst others, the destruction of the Ottoman Armenians. Moses points out that once we take into account the wider context of inter-imperial rivalry and conflict, the Ottoman state's decline and the nationalist drive to homogenize territories inhabited by diverse peoples, a more plausible hypothesis is that the genocide was motivated by political paranoia and an obsessive focus on national security. So, unless we want a definition of genocide that excludes the Armenian case, then we'd better throw out the idea that for X to count as a genocide, X must be racially motivated. In Axis Rule, Lemkin conceived of the Nazi assault on the East in light of Europe's imperial and colonial history. Through various means, the Nazis set about destroying the national pattern of various subject peoples. This was meant to facilitate the colonization of their land and the imposition of the German national pattern on the conquered territories and on any population that remained behind, any non-German population. So this has led, again, the historian Dirk Moses to observe that for Lemkin, and this is a quote, "Genocide is a special form of foreign conquest and occupation. It was necessarily imperial and colonial in nature. In particular, genocide aimed to permanently tip the demographic balance in favor of the occupier." So the conception of genocide that I've outlined for you can accommodate the idea that settler colonialism under certain conditions, will count as genocidal. So, for example, if the goals are homogenous settlement and the gaining of a relative independence in the economic and other spheres of life, then those goals cannot be attained if there's a distinct group with its own political aspirations in the territory that's coveted by the settler society. The group must therefore be removed, which entails the destruction of its social, political, and economic institutions and the liquidation of its established way of life. What cannot be said, I think, is that settler colonialism is inherently genocidal. So, for example, there's historical cases in which conquest and settlement are accompanied just by repressive policies, not by destructive policies. And genocide can take place, I think, in a range of other contexts other than the settler colonial. Finally, imperial expansion has at times involved genocide, but no colonial settlement. So, and then ethnic cleansing and forcible assimilation can also, in certain circumstances, according to the view I defend, count as instances of the phenomenon. All right, so that's the outline of how I understand the concept of genocide. So now I want to just talk briefly about whether the use of the word is appropriate in the case of Israel. So in the first edition of The Birth of the Palestinian Refugee Problem, Benny Morris famously argued that while Israeli forces may, in some instances, have deliberately expelled Palestinian civilians, the departure of the vast majority of the Arab population was brought about by the circumstances of the war in 1948. In other words, Morris at one point thought that, and still thinks, that there was no master plan for the expulsion of the Palestinians. Morris's account was challenged by a number of different scholars. So Norman Finkelstein, for example, argued that the evidence that Morris had uncovered actually supports the drawing of a different conclusion than the one that he actually draws. Nur Masalha focused on how the idea of transfer had developed in Zionist thinking and argued that the link between this discourse and the expulsion of the Palestinians should not be overlooked. And then, of course, in the revised version of The Birth of the Palestinian Refugee Problem, Benny Morris acknowledges that the Israeli military had played a much more significant role in the removal of the Palestinians. While he insisted that still that there was no overarching plan, he conceded that the military and political leadership had seen in the war an opportunity to attain a key objective demanded by the logic of the Zionist project. In The Ethnic Cleansing of Palestine, Ilan Pape outlines in great detail the meticulous preparations for the removal of the non-Jewish population that was undertaken by Ben-Gurion and his inner circle. And he also shows that these preparations were used in the course of the war. So on Pape's account, the removal of the Palestinians was a coordinated enterprise that was managed all the way from the top. Scholarship on the 1948 war is now dominated by Pape and the other so-called revisionist historians. As far as I know, and this is the really significant point, none of them dispute the claim that Israeli forces contributed in a deliberate and substantial way to the destruction of Palestinian society during the 1948 war. And of course, the facts about the scale of the devastation are now very well known. 800,000 or close to 800,000 Palestinians were expelled. 531 villages were destroyed, 11 urban centers were emptied of their inhabitants, and in excess of 5,000 people were killed in massacres. The sociologist Martin Shaw, in an essay titled Palestine in an International Historical Perspective on Genocide, observes, and correctly in my view, that, quote, this creates a prima facie strong case for considering the events of 1948 partially within a genocide framework. So what the Palestinians call the Nakba was an unfolding process that involved the elimination of social and political institutions, mass expulsion and forced marches, the deliberate killing of innocent civilians, theft and widespread destruction of homes and other property, including sites of historical significance, erasure and replacement of Palestinian symbols and place names, and other measures that underlined the essential foundations of the life of the group. At the time, the Palestinians were an intergenerational group, with an established culture and way of life. So there's no reason to think that they weren't quote-unquote eligible for genocide. The issue of what motivated the destruction of Palestinian society is moot because, as I've already noted, the inclusion of any kind of motive requirement in a definition of genocide is undesirable. The hate crime model, for instance, implies that that a paradigm of the phenomenon, the Armenian genocide, doesn't count as such. I should also note that, the inclusion of a motive requirement is problematic from a legal standpoint as well. What it does is it unnecessarily narrows the offense, and it allows people who have actually committed the crime to, evade prosecution. Okay. So then the question becomes, was Palestinian society deliberately destroyed in 1948? One could claim that since no respectable scholar contends that there was a single master plan for terminating the existence of the group, the intentionality requirement was not satisfied. But there's a really serious and I think actually fatal problem with this line of reasoning. Simply put, the requirement that there has to be a master plan is far too stringent. The vast majority of widely recognized historical instances of genocide fail to satisfy it. And while there was no single overarching policy, the Haganah, which was the largest of the pre-state Zionist military organizations, they did draw up a number of operational plans for the conquest and ethnic cleansing of different parts of the country. And one of these, of course, was Plan D. So it's difficult to see why these plans don't count as evidence of intent. And in any case, it's possible to infer mens rea even in the absence of documentary evidence. As in other cases of settler colonialism, the primary objective in Israel's case was homogeneous settlement and independence in the economic and other spheres of life. This objective, as I've already noted, cannot be attained if there is a distinct group with its own political aspirations on the territory that's coveted by the settlers. The group must therefore be removed, which entails the destruction of its institutions, its culture, and its way of life. But if the destruction of a group is a means to the attainment of the primary objective, then it's neither merely foreseen, nor is it the result of the perpetrator's reckless pursuit of that goal. The elimination of the group is intended. In other words, the deliberate nature of what was done in 1948 follows straightforwardly from the logic of the Zionist project itself. Okay, so that's the conception of genocide and my argument for why the events of 1948 fit the conception. There's another issue here, which is, you know, does the concept of genocide apply to what Israel did subsequent to the events of 1948? And I think there is a case for making that claim. I'm not going to defend it here, but it's maybe something that we can talk about in the discussion. So finally, just something really quickly about the debate in genocide studies. So there's an excellent paper, I recommend that you all read it, if you can, titled Nakba Memoricide, Genocide Studies and the Zionist-Israeli Genocide of Palestine. This paper is by Haifa Rashid, Damien Short, and John Docker. And in that paper, they describe the status quo in genocide studies in the following way. Quote, genocide studies is haunted by an absence and a fear. The absence is of any sustained and continuing discussion of Zionist Israel as a possible example of a nation founded on genocide. The fear is of becoming another victim of Zionist intimidation and retaliatory attacks if there were to be such a discussion. In Foucault's terms, genocide studies is uneasily aware that Zionism as a worldwide movement with a vigilant scholarly and ideological wing is a panopticon. Genocide studies knows it's being watched and can be threatened with vilification at any moment, even in a preemptive and gratuitous way. To fend off such attacks, it has chosen to be intellectually submissive, that is, to suppress a key Socratic foundation of intellectual life, which is to follow inquiry wherever it may lead. And so there have been some papers written about Palestine and genocide, very few, but one of the people, as I mentioned earlier, who's written one is Martin Shaw, and he's argued that there's a strong case for using the term genocide in this context. There was a debate between him and the historian Omer Bartov, which was subsequently published in the Journal of Genocide Research. And it's interesting that in that debate, Bartov responds to the very sort of well-developed and detailed arguments that Shaw makes in emotive terms, right? Suggesting, and this is a quote, that what Shaw meant to do was to delegitimize the state and to say that it was born in the blood of innocence and should therefore also go down in blood. Bartov added that you do not make peace with people by telling them that they have no right to exist because they were born in sin. So this kind of response is a reflection of what by now is a familiar pattern in discussions of Zionism and Israel. Carefully developed substantive arguments are met with appeals to emotion, attempts to change the subject, ad hominem attacks, propaganda, and the ruining of people's careers. I think that the right response to this is to just continue making the arguments. Thank you.
Mohammed, what do you think would, I worked in genocide studies also, Sudan, Darfur, and so on. I said, hello, Mohammed. I'm wanting to know if, first of all, I'm in agreement with you that we could make a very strong case for Israel-Palestine being a case of genocide. So let me just clear that up. You heard that, right? Okay, that's significant. But I'm wondering what it would accomplish if we were able to show this. And I wrote an article called By Any Other Name. And what I did was to describe the situation in Darfur that, as far as I was concerned, fit every single characteristic of genocide by most definitions, except for being able to prove intention by the state. So my attitude was, so what? So we can't prove the intention by the state, but we can still act on it as genocide. We can talk about genocidal actions, as Leo Cooper does. We can talk about genocide through attrition, as some Sudanists do. We could talk about genocide through sex-based, gender-based assault, as many feminists and others are doing. What would it add if we were to follow the technical definition, at least the Geneva Convention? What would it add to our struggle?
I think it's a really, really good question. First of all, you know, I'm a philosopher, so necessarily I'm impractical. One of the really important things is that I think that this really improves our understanding of the policies that have been pursued by Israel. And I think, you know, it links, for example, the events of 1948 to the policies that have been pursued by Israel after 1967. So there's this, sort of, I think, intellectual reason for using the word. But in practical terms, I find the discourse on Palestine sort of confusing. And I could sort of understand why somebody who's not used to it would come in and all of these different words are getting used, right? Apartheid, settler colonialism, imperialism. I think it sends a consistent message and a very clear one that can be understood if you use, you know, one overarching term to describe what's happened in Palestine since 1948. I think having that kind of clear, consistent message is important, and it might make the case more persuasive.
This question for Nada, I believe. In content of your comments about Zionism, how you can classify what happens in the last few days? You have one Jewish Moroccan who got killed by the Israeli army, and another, and a witness, he thought this is, you know, clear racism. Then the one which is more clearer than that, it is the situation of the Eritrean guy who got shot. He was denied any health service, emergency service. Then they stepped on his body after he died. Is this racism, which can be classified as racism, or what?
Yes, there is no doubt in my mind that Zionism also is racism. It's beyond racism. It's more than racism. It's settler colonialism, apartheid, genocide, all of that, as well as racism. I think, actually, your question was better addressed by Jeff earlier, who said that the regrets that Israelis expressed upon the fact that this person they just killed was Eritrean rather than Palestinian means that the Palestinian is inherently killable. It's okay to kill Palestinians. The only mistake that happened there was not the killing of someone, but the killing of an Eritrean who was mistaken for a Palestinian. So Zionism, in some ways, makes it acceptable, necessitates the killings of the killing of Palestinians. Yes, that is a form of racism.
But the Eritrean, he is much darker than Palestinians. I cannot.
All right, anti-Arab racism. I mean, okay, one of the other things that I was talking about, and I think it's a very significant success of or consequence of Zionism, is fragmentation. I mean, I was talking about how the Palestinian people has been fragmented. So that we speak of Gaza, we speak of 48, we speak of 67, we speak of the West Bank, we speak of the diaspora. We speak of all these as fragmented. If we are a fragmented people, and I was talking, my paper was, let's end this fragmentation, and as we gather together and come back together, in some ways, and actually that's the title of the last chapter in my book is We Are Greater Than the Sum of Our Parts, because we actually are more than this fragmented coming together, because Zionism from Palestine has as an expansionist movement has gone beyond. So this is a long way of saying that the fragmentation that Zionism operates, that Zionism hinges on, also would say, so killing of an Arab, even though significantly pigment-wise we may be a lighter shade of brown than an Eritrean, is okay, whereas the pigmentation is part of the fragmentation, and it doesn't matter who's darker and who's lighter. There is a fragmentation that takes place within Zionism, a fragmentation of the people, a fragmentation of the classes within Israel, of within Jews themselves, and so on. So to be anti-Zionist is also to be anti these distinctions and these fragmentations that Zionism imposes upon us, that we tend to reproduce as we then speak within the same discourse of, but wait, the Eritrean is darker, so why are we shocked at the fact that they would be remorseful over the killing of an Eritrean more than the killing of a Palestinian?
Thank you for those amazing papers all around. Nada used the expression slow genocide that I think maybe Ilan Pape coined for the last Gaza attack, but it may have a longer history. And apart from asking Mohammed if that's a philosophically allowable definition of a genocide, I think it's actually very revealing. Perhaps to echo Sari's thing about the ineffectiveness of the IDF, if it is a genocide, it's revealed more in the intent and the logic of Zionism as a political philosophy and a practice than it is in its actual accomplishment, since the Palestinian people are still there and they persist. It also opens up the discussion that Dina ended with, insofar as the assault on education is not merely the destruction of institutions from time to time or the interference with access to education, but actually an attempt, I think the Right to Education website says this, to destroy the means of reproduction of Palestinian life and culture as a whole. I'm kind of wondering if in the multiple ways in which we describe the Zionist project as settler colonialism, as apartheid, as a form of genocide, we're not being symptomatic first of all, of a kind of incoherence and unintelligibility of not our political philosophies, but of the liberal political philosophies that we're actually expected to use in order to describe political situations. And after this morning's panel also, I began to wonder, since for me, engaging in boycott, engaging in BDS, is not just a practice of activism, but a practice of thought. If you think that what's actually happening here today, and in the course of the BDS movement as a whole, is not actually a very productive transformation of our categories that is ongoing as a result of struggle, and that maybe what Dina refers to as that modality of political intelligence being incoherent, is that, that perhaps what is happening for us is that every means that we use, which within liberal philosophy is an end, like rights, like legality and so forth, is actually becoming a means to transcend that. And the, in fact, the productivity of the movement is the things that we're hearing here today, which are pushing beyond certain paradigms. Maybe NYC SJP is groping for something like that also in asking what the limits are of BDS. But I think what's becoming clear to me in this conference is that, that the thinking we are forced to do in order to engage with a really very old and easily describable set of categories of oppression is demanding of us something like the production of the new.
I have a comment and also a question for Nada. My comment is that when you were listing the victims of Zionism, you forgot to mention Central Americans. As you know, in 1980s, during the Civil War, the arms were coming from Israel, and that was a major, major factor in the brutality of that war. And also now, a lot of violence which is happening in Central America, especially Guatemala. Guatemala has become the center of the international arms trade by Israeli, mainly former Israeli army officers. So they're still paying a huge price for Israeli involvement. Mm-hmm. But my question is about the term of diaspora that you use. You use the term of diaspora, but you kept talking about the Palestinian after Nakba, basically, the ones who were forced out of whatever form they took. But there are hundreds of thousands, if not millions, of Palestinians and their descendants who left during the Ottoman Empire and 1920s. Do you consider them as a Palestinian diaspora? Because that is a very different community than what we know of Palestinian refugees and Palestinian after 1948. So I'm asking this question because I'm doing some work on diaspora myself, and it's very confusing for me. Maybe we should start using Palestinian exiles for after 1948.
The expulsion versus the post-Ottoman, if you want, the Ottoman diaspora versus the Zionist expulsion.
Yeah,
I think that's a good distinction to make.
So it's really, it's a very sympathetic question, yes. I'm hesitant to use genocide, personally. And I'm hesitant because it requires inhabiting a subject position where I have been destroyed in order to argue for genocide. And I just would like you, perhaps you, to reflect on this question of legibility, that in order, that one that Jeff also referenced perhaps in his talk earlier this morning, one in which in order to become legible, in order to be translated in a particular culture and political context, one has to even give up oneself, right? One has to be alienated from oneself in order to become legible. And perhaps this is the legibility you were trying to avoid in describing, in sort of citing Rancière. And so I wonder whether you have thoughts on that. If you legally, I can understand the legal argument, fully understand it, I'm a lawyer. But I still want to think about the political price, whether it does require destruction, and what does it mean to act politically, to persist, to struggle, to live in this world in the aftermath of that total genocidal destruction. Isn't it too early?
Well, I mean, maybe it's... are you objecting to the use of the word?
No, I'm not objecting.
eligible. Oh, okay. Well, maybe eligible is not the best word to use. But, you know, I couldn't think of anything else. I do think that, you know, one of the things you have to do when you're trying to understand genocide is to draw this distinction between the groups that can be genocide victims and the ones that can't. But actually, let me just address a couple of other things that you said then. Well, first of all, this whole thing about sort of legality. I mean, I'm actually really, really suspicious of the definition of genocide that's in the UN Convention. I think it's deeply problematic and should probably be overhauled. So my view is entirely philosophical. I actually sort of, for the most part, ignore the legal aspects. Apart from, for example, saying, well, you know, in the definition of genocide in the UN Convention, it says that groups have to be destroyed as such, which seems to imply that there has to be some kind of, you know, sort of racial motive behind it. And I think that's, you know, there's not much of an argument for that. I try to get away from all that sort of legal debate. So, I mean, I think that the characteristic harm of genocide is a loss of social vitality for the individual. That's a serious harm, right? But it's not the worst harm that an individual can experience. So actually, one of the implications of this view is that, you know, genocide might not be the worst of the international crimes, right? It's not clear that it's worse than, for example, mass rape and war, and so on. So I don't think that by applying the label genocide, you know, at least on the view that I defend, you're claiming complete sort of victimization. So just to clarify that. I published about genocide that might sort of gives a fuller account. Okay.